Hello everybody. Okie dokie. Today we have a bit of a tutorial in case anyone wants to basically test, do the same kind of testing that I've been doing, where the idea, the goal is to figure out what settings in Retroarch using the RetroTINK Raspberry Pi hat most accurately match the original console hardware. So if anyone out there is interested in doing their own testing, or if you don't like my settings, my testing so far, and you want to confirm for yourself, this is basically what you need to do to do that. You can see Saya Jean here, sorry if I probably mispronounced your name there, asked, "Hey Kevin, I saw your site with all those recommendation settings for consoles. Would you have handy some for TurboGrafx-16 and PSX? I do have a PSX, but I'm going to be getting a TurboGrafx-16 soon." Etc. etc. Then he says down here, "If you can make a more detailed tutorial on how you do your test, we can maybe join the party." So if anybody wants to join the party, that would be awesome, because this is some seriously tedious stuff. And while it's fun, you know, it would be great for other people. You know, my settings, hell, they're probably slightly wrong. So if somebody else can figure out something better, that'd be fantastic. So anyway, the first thing you need to do, obviously, is get a Raspberry Pi 3 Model B, which, as far as I know, is like the most recent version of the Raspberry Pi. You can do that from wherever you like. Newegg's okay. It used to be a lot better, but now they're just okay. This one here, it's the full kit. So you got the board, you got the power supply, and you got the case. Let's see. You also need to get something to store the operating system on, which you need a micro SD card. Here we have some micro SD HC or high capacity cards. You can see they're terribly cheap, $13-14 for 32 gigs. You can get a 64 gig one for like $12 somewhere. So anyway, micro SD card, HC, high capacity. And it doesn't have to be that big. Leica, you're typically going to be storing your ROMs, your games, on like a pen drive or something like that, as opposed to what the actual operating system, Leica, will be stored on. So you really don't even need 32 gigs. You can get a very small one, whatever, it doesn't matter. The next thing you need to do, obviously, is get a RetroTINK. You can go to RetroTINK.com. There's several variations of this. It really depends on what you want. The one that I have is actually this one here. You have your composite output. It's your infamous yellow cable for video. You have your S video output here, which is excellent. Most of the old systems actually only supported composite out. I still recommend, even if you're trying to go for the old look, I seriously recommend using S video for pretty much everything on the RetroTINK. Composite's alright, but S video still has that old school look, but it's a little bit clearer. It's much easier to work with. And these are actually component outputs. Now, not a lot of standard definition CRT televisions actually had a component input, and there is a negligible difference between what you're going to get between S-video here and the component output. So the RetroTINK S should do you nicely. There's actually one that has RGB outputs on it, which I believe is the RetroTINK C here. Pretty much no standard definition televisions actually have RGB inputs on them. You'd be looking more for like a PVM, like a professional video monitor, or a BVM, a broadcast video monitor, which are very high-end, expensive CRT televisions that, as far as I know, you know, really only people in the television, you know, network broadcast industry, and probably the graphic artists that designed that created the pixel art that actually worked for the game studios had these things. Some people really like this stuff. I really don't care. I want the old school experience, you know, like when I was a kid. So composite and S video for the win. So get your RetroTINK. Fits on top of the Raspberry Pi on these pins. Well, the GPIO pins, which are right here, fits on top of those. And your next step for testing, remember this is for comparing original consoles against the emulated output via a Raspberry Pi and a RetroTINK. So to be able to do that, so you don't have to constantly plug in and unplug the audio and video outputs, well, really just the video outputs, you're going to want to get a switch, an audio video switch. So you can see this one has composite and S video. And it is, I'm not sure how many ports. I would get one, it depends on how many systems you have. I would get one with at least four input ports and one output port. You can get one with more. They have every different kind of one you can possibly imagine. So just be sure you get the one that meets your testing conditions. If you're going to be using S video, then you really don't need one that has component or anything weird like that. Some of these can get really expensive. I have a pretty straightforward, it's a four ports and one port out, and it supports both S video and a composite. And it, of course, defers to S video. So if it's getting a component and an S video signal at the same time, it'll choose the better signal, which is S video. So get one of those so you can hook up your game systems and hook up the Raspberry Pi, and then connect the output to that to your CRT television. And next, the operating system here is Leica or Laka. And I actually have a pre-configured image for this, so you can set it up yourself. If you do that, you're going to need to overwrite the config text with the config text on my website. So you can get the correct HDMI timings and all of that. You can also do it yourself. If you know what you're doing, then you really don't need to mess with my pre-configured image. You can just get Leica from the source here and configure it yourself. If not, you want to go to my website, 8virtues.com/Leica/hat. That'll give you this directory listing. Here is the config text that has the 2048 by 240 HDMI timings, which is currently what I'm testing. It also has the now deprecated 1600 by 240 HDMI timings, which the settings, my website currently lists the settings just for the 1600 mode. Soon that will be updated to reflect both that and the newer 2048 mode. So you can see if you click on that, this is the text file that you actually need to overwrite the Leica config text file with. Down here you see the 1600 HDMI timings. The current version, actually, let me refresh it, see what pops up. There we go. There's the 2048 HDMI timings, which are commented out since I haven't published those settings yet for RetroArch. Anyway, let's go back. So you can download that from here. This is actually the image, the current image. It's 420 megabytes, so I've actually shrank it down some. I repartitioned it so it would be smaller. So you want to download this file here, and you want to image the SD card for the Raspberry Pi with that. So I can show you quickly how that's done. You download that image. I'll just go to where it's downloaded, which is da-na-na-na-na. Actually, that's the full Leica distro, isn't it? Let's see. Where the hell is it? Home slash. That's actually not in home, is it? Media slash data slash www slash Leica slash hat. Okie dokie, there it is. So in Linux and Windows, I'm sure it's super easy. Not, but you can figure it out. In Linux, after you've downloaded the file, you just right-click it, say make bootable USB stick. Excuse me. Select the target, which is my 64 gig SD card. You hit right. Guess your password. Right. So we're writing my custom image to the SD card now. I'm actually gonna have to switch over in a minute from desktop capture to my camera so you can see what it looks like on my CRT. So I will do that in a moment. Okay, once the pre-configured image boots up, it's gonna be using the RGUI menu driver. If you're doing this, you're from scratch here, it's not going to be using RGUI. It's going to be using XMB, which looks like a PlayStation 3 interface. That actually doesn't work with these ultra-wide 1600 or 2048 HDMI timings. Doesn't like it at all. XMB handles it much more gracefully. So you'll always want to use X and B for any sort of ultra wide mode. So these are your basic settings. What you want to do is look at the video settings here. So go into settings, video, and there's a few key items here that you want to pay attention to. Most you will want to leave the default. You'll always want your custom, or I'm sorry, your aspect ratio to be set to custom. The other four values here, which are going to be the ones that you're manipulating as you're attempting to calibrate these settings with original hardware, is your custom aspect ratio X and Y position. It's these here. I'm going to remove this reticle just for now. Try to. It's masking tape. All right. That's better. So your custom aspect ratio X and Y position, that basically just moves the image left and right. It doesn't change the size of it or anything like that. Next to here, your custom aspect ratio width and height. Your width is always going to want to match the HDMI timing width. So if you're using the 1600 HDMI timings, you'll want this to be 1600. Now, here's a part that's a little bit interesting. The 1600 and the 2048 mode and any other HDMI timings, they always have a height of 240 pixels. However, due to the way the individual emulator cores output their frame buffer, in other words, if Nestopia, the NES emulator, if it outputs 224 pixels vertically, this setting needs to reflect that. So the custom aspect ratio height actually should not be 240, even though the HDMI timings are set to 240 vertically. It needs to match the emulator's output, the core's output. Now the core's output for, let's say, the Nintendo Entertainment System, the NES, the core's output should be 240, but for whatever reason, they cropped it. They set it to 224. That's a mistake by the developers of the emulators for various reasons. So regardless, you want to set this. For example, let's say the Sega Master System is 192. It's the Sega Master System emulator actually outputs 192 rows. You want to set this to 192. The width, however, should always match the HDMI timing width, in this case, 2048. So these four settings here, these are the ones you're actually going to be adjusting, trying to calibrate RetroArch with or to the original hardware. Other settings, these will always be the same. You want to have integer scale off. You want to have threaded video off. I know you want to turn it on, but don't do it. It will perform better off, believe it or not. Let's see, hard GPU sync is useless on the Raspberry Pi. It does nothing, so just have it off. And the only other one is a crop overscan, for the most part, should be set to off. There may be an emulator here and there where it needs to be on for it to output correctly, but I recommend this being off. For example, Nestopia outputting 224 rows instead of 240. If you turn crop overscan on, you're going to see even more of that. What that does is it actually crops or removes the height and width selectively from the frame buffer in the emulator, which is not what you want at all. Ideally, the emulator cores should actually output the exact same frame buffer dimensions of the original hardware. Sadly, they don't quite do that yet. Hopefully that'll change. And of course, bilinear filtering, that's smoothing, you want that off, because if your settings are correct, you'll have absolutely no need for that whatsoever. So in any case, back to the main four settings here. You can see they're not the default values, which would be zero here and zero there, 2048 here and probably 240 here. So let's see, let's test a system here. Let's go to the next step here is basically you want to load a game in emulation and pause it on a known frame. And then you want to load a game on an original system and pause it on that same frame. So we're going to start, with Super Mario World here. So let me turn on my Super Nintendo. I'm going to switch over to the Super Nintendo, which is now off. I'm going to turn it on. Okay, bringing up Super Mario World.
Yeah, when everything's moving around like this, you just can't test it. So you want to find a frame that's good for testing with some clear edges, preferably something where there's like a pattern, like a checkerboard pattern of pixels, which this game has right at the beginning. So pause. Okay, so the guy on the right here fell down, touched the grass, and is still facing to the right. And I paused it. So we're going to try to pause it on the same frame in emulation. So this is obviously a real Super Nintendo. We're going to switch back over to RetroArch. Going to load up. I'm not actually sure what settings are in here right now. Let's just zero them out for fun, just so we can see what's going on. So these would be like the default settings. So you had a new system. You're about to calibrate it. The emulator, you already know the actual emulator for it outputs 224 rows. So we'll leave that there. Obviously, HDMI timing's 2048 for the width. So let's load Super Mario World. Super Nintendo. Super Mario World. Open it up. All right. I'm going to try to pause it on that same frame. Back to here, we see Super Nintendo. The enemy just landed on the grass, and he's still facing to the right. That'll be our challenge here, especially in this game, because it limits how quickly you can pause it so you can't cheat with the slow motion trick. So let's see if we can do the same frame. Ooh, too early. And because it limits the pause rate, I'm not going to be able to unpause it and pause it again fast enough to get him to hit. You can see the difference here. It's Raspberry Pi, Super Nintendo, he's too far down. Now, you don't actually have to pause it so everything looks exactly the same. As long as it looks mostly the same, it's fine. Now, if we were actually going to use this enemy here as a point of reference for testing, then of course it would need to be in the same place. But fortunately, at least in this game, in this particular scene, we have, thank you, phone. We have multiple points of reference from which we can compare. Like this stippling or this grid pattern here. We have some clear vertical lines here, horizontal lines there, and here, plenty of places we can test. So basically what we're doing is switching back and forth between the two systems, and we are adjusting the position. You can hit F1, actually, to bring up this menu here, and then back out, hit B, back out, go back into settings, video. Back down to your position here. So, and you can actually adjust that and see what it's doing. Now remember, despite the fact that the Super Nintendo is basically outputting 256 pixels in width, the Raspberry Pi is running with a width of 2048. So you can adjust this quite a bit and it won't move that much. Vertically, however, it's still 240 pixels, even though the emulator's outputting 224, so it'll move much more. You can see how much more dramatically it shifts. So this is what we're trying to match between the two. So you can do it by eye. You can put pieces of tape on the screen. You can hold your finger against the screen and close one eye as you switch back and forth to figure out if it needs to go up, down, left, or right. You can also use a digital camera on a tripod and take a photograph of the Pi output, and then take a photograph of the console output and actually look at those photographs in a image editor like the GIMP or Photoshop and try to discern what the adjustment needs to be. Again, as I mentioned before, this can be very tedious. So we'll see. Okay, you can see here, okay, the actual Super Nintendo is much lower than the Raspberry Pi. So if the Super Nintendo is lower, we'll want to make the Pi lower. So let's try going down 4. Okay, see it needs to go down a little bit more. So we'll make it 5. And this is it right here. Looks like maybe it needs to go down one more. And if you want to get rid of the screen, you can just hit F1 again. You want to see a clear comparison. So this is a RetroArch, RetroTINK. Okay, that's pretty good. Maybe it needs to go down one more. You can also see that the Super Nintendo here, Super Nintendo, appears to be a little bit to the left. So you can hit F1 again. You can actually move that a little bit to the left. And this is really it. Pretty close. Still looks like the RetroTINK's a little bit too high. So let's move it down one more. See if that looks better. Okay, we got the vertical offset correct. That matches perfectly. However, the Super Nintendo here, it's a little bit too far to the left, which means we need to move RetroArch a little bit to the right, actually. So we're going to bump that over 2. Looks like we overcompensated by moving it to the left 4. Now we're just going to move it to the left 2. Test again. Oh, we need to move it to the left about 1, it looks like. And this is like the nature of the game. Again, so you just keep doing this. And the interesting thing is, I don't care if you put your finger on the screen. I don't care if you put tape on the screen. It doesn't matter. Ultimately, once you get it as close as you can get it with the eye checks, the tape checks, the finger checks, whatever, you are going to need to mount a true digital camera. You're going to need to mount it to a tripod. You're going to need to take photographs with a time delay or a remote control so it doesn't vibrate the camera, it doesn't move the tripod, and then you will have to compare the images extremely carefully side by side in a paint program to make the final adjustments. Once you have that, you might have to do a second pass where you do it again, but you move the camera much closer. So you could focus, for example, on Mario here. You know, you could zoom in on a specific point. So you can actually see the phosphors in the camera, and again, do comparison shots between the RetroTINK and the original system, just extremely close-up shots. You'll want to put the camera in macro mode, like you're taking a picture of a flower that's right in front of the lens, and you'll need to compare those side by side and then adjust the RetroArch settings accordingly. So that pretty much sums it up. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments or go to the Discord chat, which will be linked to in the video description. And I hope this helps you both understand what I and others are trying to accomplish. And if you're trying to help us or help yourself, I hope this helps you do that. So anyway, have a good day. Talk to you later.